Assalamu alaikum, dear students. Welcome back in lecture 2 of the DDM lecture. So, dear students, basically we start a DDM method in lecture 1. We see that we will discuss about the introduction of DDM method, that how we can distribute basically a slab system into interior frames and exterior frames. And then what is middle strip and what is column strip, and how we can determine the width of the middle strip and column strip. So before starting this lecture, you people must need to go and watch that lecture 1 to understand what is interior frame and exterior frame, and basically what are the requirements and limitations of DDM method. So in this lecture is basically, dear students, I will want to share with you some other technical terms, or you can say some theoretical portion of the DDM method. Whenever we are designing a flat slab system, so in that flat system sometimes you have a shear problem, because shear capacity is very huge along the center lines of the columns. So in that case, basically our shear requirement of the slab is not completed. To safeguard the slab against the shear failure, basically we provide different arrangement of steels along the center lines of the columns. Because in the center line regions of the columns, there are a huge concentrated forces exists basically. Like in this figure, you can see that the whole shear concentration basically lies along the column region. Okay, so there is a shear concentration, and due to that shear concentration, sometimes punching shear will occur in a column. Slab is basically leaving the column area and move downwards. So that is a kind of shear failure. To avoid this kind of failure, we basically provide column capital or drop panels, or sometimes we provide, if you are not providing drop panel to the column or column capital to the column, so basically in that case we will provide shear reinforcement. So that shear reinforcement basically safeguard, or you can say avoid, the slab from punching shear. So there are different ways that how we can safeguard the slab system against shear failure. So for that purpose, we can provide the shear heads. Okay, and so you can see that how we can provide those kind of shear reinforcement. Okay, in later stages, inshallah, I will discuss about that. To avoid that shear reinforcement, basically we have different options. We can either provide a column capital, either we can provide a drop panel, or either we can provide a shear reinforcement. So we have different options to safeguard the slab system against that shear failure. But this is a general overview to you people, that basically the slab thickness is a problem for us, because in flat slab system or flat slab system, we are searching for the appropriate thickness of the slab. Okay, so basically there is a serviceability factor occurred. The flexion criteria is basically controlling, although the slab thickness needed is smaller, but to control the shear failure, we need to provide a large thickness to the slab, because the punching shear is basically a demanding that the slab thickness should be large. So for that purpose, we will provide different kinds of shear reinforcement along the center lines of the columns. You can see there a shear head is provided. This is a steel beam which is provided along the center lines of the columns. Okay, they safeguard against the column punching shear. Similarly, you can provide bent up bars. You can see here This is the basically the region where the shear failure basically occur, and a shear crack is developed. Okay, so to avoid that shear failure, we provide the bent up bars. Similarly, this kind of shear reinforcement can be provided. Okay, with a four leg stirrups. So there are different ways and how we can provide this kind of shear reinforcement. You can either provide a beam along the center line of the column. For example, you can see here. So we will provide a beam shear reinforcement as well as flanger reinforcement along the center line of the column to the both ways. Okay, up to a certain distance from the face of the column. To basically, the whole purpose of this kind of reinforcement is to avoid the slant column punching the slab. Okay, so inshallah we will deal with that this topic in later stages. Okay, next, moving towards the depth limitation and stiffness of that. So this is basically we have to fix out, or we have to find out the thickness of the slab, of the flat slab, but how much thickness will be provided. Okay, so the first case is that slabs with both interior beams. Now if we are not providing interior beams, okay, one thing I want to share with you, people, that sometimes you provide a boundary, or you can say an edge beam. Okay, you can provide an edge beam, and okay, we provide an edge beam. Edge beam is basically provided along the boundary, like in this region. Okay, here, this is the boundary of the whole slab system. We provide only one beam at the periphery of the whole slab system, and if this kind of beam is provided along the edge line of the slab, this kind of slab system is considered to be the slab system along the edge beam. So in this case, basically one option is this. The other option is that we do not provide this kind of slabs beam system, and there is no beam provided in the slab system. The slab is just a plateau, like the picture which you can see here in this slab system. Okay, there is no boundary beam. You can see here clearly that there is no beam, no edge beam, and no interior beam. So what is interior beam? Basically, interior beam is provided along the each center line of the columns. You can say there is a beam, and similarly there is a beam, similarly there is a beam, there is a beam. Okay, each center line along the center line of the column in both longitudinal direction and in short direction, we provide basically beams. So that is another case. In that case, what will be the thickness of the slab? Okay, what will be the thickness of the slab? And when the edge beam is present, what will be the thickness of the slab? And when there is no beam, neither at edges, neither at interior portion, interior beams, so what will be the thickness, or you can say depth of the slab? Okay, so these three are the basic cases which control the thickness, you can say the depth of the beam. So basically, here we can see that how we can find out that depth. So slabs without interior beams. Here it says, for a slab without interior beams spanning between its supports and with a ratio of its foot, basically in this kind of cases, when there is edge beam, no interior beam. So stiffness plays a role, and stiffness of the both material, like a beam and slab material, control the thickness of the beam. So basically there is a limitation that your slab thickness should not be less than 5 inches. Okay, thickness of the both slabs with drop panels outside the panels will be 4 inches. Okay, now this table is basically taken from the SA code, and you can search this this table in the code, and you can find this table as well, that what will be the depth limitation. These are the coefficients which we will discuss in later stages, and basically these tables can be present in SEL code. Okay, you can see 13.3.7 and 13.3.5. Okay, so here if you can search it, 13.13, this is the moment coefficient, sorry, but the thickness table is, so basically student, this is the table minimum thickness of slab without material beams. This is basically chapter 9 of the SEL code. Okay, so you can see here in this table, as well as in the coordinate book, you can see this table here. These are the minimum requirements or minimum thickness, okay, of slabs without interior beams. Okay, so you can see the yield strength of the steel, and this table is basically exterior panels, okay, and interior panels. Now, so basically, we can see that the bulk drop panels and with drop panels, if you do not provide the drop panels, and if you have edge beams, then you use these coefficients. If you have edge beams, then you use these coefficients. And if you have interior panels with, okay, so without drop panels, you will use these coefficients. Okay, so drop panel is defined in SEL code. Slabs with beam between columns along exterior edges. So this table is basically used for determining the thickness of the slab system. Okay. So the another important factor is alpha f. Okay. Now what is basically this one? This is a kind of coefficients which is used in case where you are providing interior beams. The slabs with beams between columns along exterior edges, the value of alpha f for the edge beam shall not be less than 0.8. So if you are providing an edge beam, basically in that case you have to find out this alpha f, and this alpha f should be greater than 0.8 for two-way construction. Plane is the basically that is the clear span. Okay, so alpha f is basically the ratio of the stiffness of the beam with the ratio of the stiffness of the slab. Okay, so basically this is the kind of the ratio. Okay, it is a factor which is the ratio of the stiffness of the beam with the stiffness of the slab. Okay, so here we have one of an example. Okay, in the McCormick book, using the SEL code, determine the minimum permissible total thicknesses required for the slabs in panels 3 and 2 for the floor system shown in figure. Okay, this is your floor system, and you can see that this is basically, you can see here. Okay, let's say this is your center line of the column. This is also a center line of the column. This is also a center line of the column. Okay, and you can see this is the center line of the column, and you can see that this is also the center line of the column. So this is panel 2, this is basically panel 3, and this is panel 4, and this is panel 1. So here you have to find out the thickness of the slab of the panel. Okay, the question is that there is an edge beam 12 inch wide and projects vertically 8 inch. So this means you have to provide an edge beam. Clear? You have to provide, this is, you can say, L beam. So the question is that you have to find out the slab thickness. But the case is that you have an edge beam, because you have three cases: when there is no edge beam, interior beam; when there is edge beam but not interior beams; and when there is interior and edge beams present. So in this case, basically you have to find out the thickness of the slab 2 and 3 open slab. So let us start this example. Now you have to find out the thickness lead thickness for panel 3 and 2 for the flow system showing, okay. Its beams are used around the building perimeter and they are 10 inch wide and extend vertically for 8 inch below the slab as, okay. So you must know this thickness, this dip of the slab is basically from this portion to this portion, okay. This is 8 inch. And the width of this layer of the beam is basically 4 inches. Clear? So they also extend 8 inch out into the slab as required by ACL. Okay. Loader of panels are used and the concrete in the slab is the same as the used in the HP. So this is also one of the most important conditions that whenever you are calculating the stiffnesses of the material, you must take care about that the slab and the beam concrete is same, steel is same, okay, because stiffness is changing. So no drop panels and the concrete in slab is the same as that in HPs. Fy is basically 60,000 Psi. Alpha F is 0. Why? Because since the interior panel has no parameter beams. So this is a very important condition, okay. Alpha F basically it works when you have a panel and a panel having beams. So as three, basically panel 3 is panel 2 and 3 have no parameter beam. You can see here there is no beam present. So therefore, in this case, alpha F comes out to be 0. Okay. So this is the one of the most important condition, because in panel 1 we have parameter beams, okay. So in panel 1 basically we will count that factor alpha f, but in 2 and 3 and 4 as well you have no parameter beams, almost no parameter beams. So therefore alpha f is basically 0. LN is the clear span, okay, center to center. The distance center to center, you will subtract the one column width from the center to center distance, you will got the clear span. Okay, so clear span is basically, it is nothing, it is the face to face distance. Okay, it is the face to face distance. So you have to find out how you can find out basically from the face to face. Okay. The center to center distance is 20 feet, so subtracting half of the column and half of the column. Okay. So you will got that center to center distance L. Okay. So LN is basically, they calculated that LN, okay, that comes out to be 16 inches. Okay. 16 inches divided by 10 inches, because you have to subtract one column left. Okay. So dividing by 12 converted from feet, clear distance between columns is 20 feet. Now this is basically what direction, this is basically they select the longer span. Okay, they select basically the longer span. You can see here that they select this distance. Okay, so this the column pairs in this direction is 16 inches. In this direction it is also 16 inches, so therefore subtracting one column width, or you can say half of the column, you see, from that side and half of the column from that side, you will get this L. Okay, so in this direction basically it is not the controlling dimension, because this one is smaller. Okay, whereas this is 16 feet, so 16 we will subtract 12 divided by 12, that comes out to be LN is smaller. Okay. So in that direction basically they find out the basically 18.67 feet. So minimum H, no, they're using the header. Okay. So as you have no warp panel and you have no beams, so therefore the delta panels and exterior panel, you have interior panels, okay. You have 60,000 psi, so you select this coefficient. Clear? You leave this coefficient and You see here, they choose their position from header, element value by 33, and insert the value by card 6.79 inches. So the slab thickness should not be less than 5 inches according to ACS. You can raise, try, you have to try 7 inches, okay? Now, this is only this slab calculation thickness calculation is only for interior panel 3. Okay? So this is remember very important detail. Okay, we are calculating the slab thickness for panel 3. Now we are calculating the slab thickness for panel 2. So basically here we have basically parameter B. Okay, so due to that parameter B, you can see we use the that factor alpha f. Okay, so therefore assume h is equal to 7 inches and compute alpha f with the reference mat to the 16.7 a center. Now as we have a parameter beam and we will got this kind of arrangement. So to find out the moment of inertia of this edge beam and as well as for this slab portion, okay, we need to, first of all, I would like to explain this L-shaped beam. This is the beam, okay, and the beam width is basically 10 inches. And you must remember that this 10 inches to the half of the center line on the column, that is 12.5, 6 inch and 6 inch. So 16 feet on centers, okay. So this is basically for if you go toward panel 2, so there is edge beam, okay. And you can see that in this direction this is 16 feet. So from the center line of the panel, or you can say from the face of this panel, there is a distance of 6 inches, the half distance of the column, and 16 feet is from center of this column to the center of this column. Okay, here you can see. Okay, so the center line from the center line of this column to the center line of this column, the distance is 16 feet, while we start 6 inches. Now, this is as L shaped beam. So you must know about the design of L-shaped and T-shaped beam. The flange width, half flange, this is half flange width, which is equal to HW, comes out to be 4 times of HR, it may be used 5 inches. Clear? The thickness of the slab is assumed to be 6-7 inches. Okay, here we are basically start that assume it is equal to 7 inches. So this is T-beam. L beam, sorry, and this is your slab, okay, to the center line of the panel, okay, half, you can say half of the panel, okay, is considered slab, is basically considered to the half of the panel, half to this side and half to this side, to 16 divided by 2, that's come down to be 8 inches, 8 feet, sorry, and adding with the you can see 16 divided by 2 plus half to the edge of the slab to the center line of the panel, that's come to be 0.02. Now the whole calculation I will do here. You can see that this is the L shaped beam. The centroid is located by using the statics. Okay, you know about this formula from engineering mechanics. Y can be given by 1 divide this L shape into two figures, figure 1 and figure 2. Calculate by 1 by 2 or 1 by 2, inserting that these values in this equation, you will get your y prime, that is the centroidal distance from the top, 6.5 inch. And that centroid basically is somewhere here, okay, it is at a distance of, it is at a distance of, 8.145 inches from the bottom. Okay, so here we have to calculate moment of inertia of this of this L-shaped beam. Either we can use parallel axis theorem, we can calculate the moment of inertia in the distant parallel axis, x-axis, okay? Moment of inertia, x-axis. Using this parallel axis theorem, R, we can use this formula as well. IB is the moment of inertia of beam equals to 1/3, 20 inches is basically the width you can see here. This is the whole flying width of the L beam that comes out to be 12 plus 8 inches, 20 inches multiplied by the distance by the width of this flange, and that comes out to be 7 minus 6.55 inches. That will be equals to 6.55 from the top, okay? So 6.55, you can see this distance is basically 6.5, okay? So B D cube by 3 plus you have to add this figure 1 in moment of inertia. So 1/3 of 12 into D cube, that is 8.45 inches, and then again you have to add this figure 3, the small portion. This is basically 8 inches, so 8 multiplied by the dip is half dip, okay? This dip is basically is 8.45 minus 6.5, that comes out to be how much? That comes out to be 0.45 inches. So you will got your moment of inertia will be, that is 4 to 5 seconds. You can calculate this moment of inertia by using parallel axis theorem, by using your statics equations, okay? Similarly, for slab, for this slab, this is L, it is a flat figure, okay, or a single figure. So 1/12 BD cube by 12, so B is 102 and B is 7 inches. So you can calculate your moment of inertia as here. So now we will calculate alpha factor. So alpha is nothing, it is just only the stiffness of the beam to the stiffness of the slab, okay? So stiffness E are constant because the complete for slab and beam is of same properties. So therefore, just inserting the values of IB and IS, you will got 1.47, which is greater than 0.8. For H beam, it is the compulsory condition for any H beam which present along the panel periphery, its alpha factor must be greater than 0.8. If it comes out to be 0.8, this means this is an H beam. Now you will back to the table and you will got the factor, or you can say coefficient for determining the length and thickness of the slab. So this is basically exterior panel, and in exterior panel we have an edge beam because we proved that this is an edge beam. So we will got this L_32. So inserting the values, we will get the answer, that is 0.566 and 6.9 inches or 7 inches. Okay. So our assumption is okay because it is lesser than 7 inches, so therefore we can use 7 inch thickness. If it comes out to be more than 7 inches, so you will repeat the process and you will select that value which is more than 7 inches. Okay, so this ends of basically that how we can calculate the slab thickness when we have no interior beams, but we have exterior edge beams. Okay, we have edge beams. Okay, so there are conditions. Okay, if you come to Venter Nelson book, you can see these conditions. Condition A says when you have a flat slab with a wall. Okay, there is a wall, and the wall is not Newtonetic. Okay, the other condition is that you have edge beam as well as your interior beams, and the other condition is when you have no beams. Okay, either at edges, either at interior support. When we have edge beams and no interior beams, and when we have a fully restraints present along the edges, because fully restrained means that do mold is basically you cannot this means that you cannot take it as a head support, okay? You can consider it as a back support. So therefore, if you have a concrete wall, you have a strong column, the dimensions are very large, like you can say 2x2 feet column, 3x3 feet column, so that fully restrain the slab from moving. Okay, they are fully absorbing the movement of the slab. Okay, so you can say that is a fully restrained. So basically, monolithic structure like wall, complete wall is present, right, in the scenery. So in each case, you can see A, B, C, D, E, you have different calculation for thickness of the slab. Okay, so let us take another example. Let us go towards another example. This is the case when you have interior beams, slab with interior beams. Okay, this example basically there is no interior beams, although we have edge beams. Now we are going to know that if we have an interior beam, then how we can calculate the slab thickness. So there is another formula. It should be remembered that LN is the longer flare span. Okay, beta is another factor which counts for the shape of the panel. Okay, that is the ratio of the long to the short flare span. Alpha FN is basically, it is the average of the stiffness of the beam and slabs. Now, if alpha FN, this is basically code restriction. Okay, you can search the restriction in code, because code explains that if your alpha FN is less than or equal to 0.2, the minimum thicknesses are obtained as they work for slab to build interior beams spanning between their supports. Then you have to take the coefficient from this table in this criteria without interior beams. Okay, this one. Without drop panels, and here you can use these coefficients. Okay, you will use these coefficients. If alpha FN is less than 0.2, if alpha FN is less than 0.2, if alpha FN exists in the limits of 2 and 0.2, then you have to find out the thickness from this formula, or even you can select 5 inch. If it comes out to less than 5 inch, then you have to choose 5 inch. Okay, if alpha FN is more than 2 inches, the thicknesses may not be less than 3.5 inch, and you choose this one. Okay, LN and FY are the inches, LN is in inches, and FY in PSI. In this formula, you must remember, okay, the LN is in inches and FY in PSI. Here, it explains a very important note for panels with discontinuous edges. If any panel, for example, present in interior panels and they are discontinuous, like sometimes you cut a panel for staircases or something like that, so we have discontinuous edges. The code 9.5.3.3d requires that edge beam be used. You have to use edge beam which have a minimum stiffness ratio alpha FN equals to 0.8, the same condition, or else that the minimum slab thicknesses as determined by the above equation will be increased by 10%. So this means that if you have an interior panel, okay, and there is a discontinuous edge, okay, you left a panel, okay, open, then the slab which is right here, you have to use an edge beam, and that edge beam alpha should be greater than 0.8, or you have to increase the thickness of the slab by 10% as calculated from these equations. Okay, these two equations. So this is a restriction. The designer may use slabs of lesser thicknesses than those required by the LC code as described in the preceding paragraph. But the flexion are computed. Now, this is another interesting discussion, that a designer uses lesser thickness as calculated by these equations. Like this equation says, the course says that you have to adopt the thickness more than 3.5 inches or 3.5 inches and you are adopting 3 inches, lesser value of as specified by the code. You can adopt that value as well, but you have to calculate your deflections and you check the deflection criteria. That is, whether your deflection is within limits or not. If they are in limits, so the code allows us that we can use those thicknesses if the deflection is greater than the limiting values, then you cannot use that value of the thickness. Okay, so this is basically a very important discussion. If you are, you people are basically designing a slab system and you adopt the minimum value, okay, so you need to calculate the deflections and check that deflection within your deflections are in ranges or they are increasing. So adjust those thicknesses as per the plan. Okay. So coming to a next example, we have a 2A slab shown in figure has been assumed to have thicknesses of 7 inches. Now they are assuming that we are adopting 7 inch thickness. Section AA in the figure, check the SA equation to determine if the slab thickness are satisfactory for an interior panel. So normal rectangle. So this is a basically an interior form and these interior panel is basically, sorry, interior panel have having interior beams. Okay. Now we have to check if we are assumed that we are providing a 7 inch thickness of slab, whether that 7 inches will be enough for the slab or not. So we have interior frames and beams. So for interior beams, we have to calculate the thickness of the slab by using the equations. So you can see there is an AA section and there is a T-shaped beam, okay? Because the interior beams which are present in slab, they are monolithic and they are working like a team. Now we can know about the design of a T-beam. The explained weight is basically equal to BW plus 2HW, or it should be less than or equal to B plus FH. Okay, so that is the condition. Okay, you people search your PRC code that how you can design a T-beam planes thickness width. Okay, so these are the dimensions which are given from this area which they use for the design. Okay, now 22 inches and VW, we have to first of all calculate the moment of inertia of this T-shirt. I think that is not difficult. You people can calculate by using the statics. You just need to find out the centroid of this section, okay, by same formula as we did in the previous example. And then using the parallel axis theorem, and by using that parallel axis theorem, you can calculate the moment of inertia of the x-axis of this figure. And the moment of inertia which is calculated for that beam section is comes out to be 18060 254. Okay, grass I of P section. Okay, and then you have to use basically you have to calculate the moment of inertia your slab. Okay, and one important thing is that one important factor is that you have to remember that you have to find out the moment of inertia of the section in two directions. Basically, you have two directions. Okay, looking to this figure, okay, we have basically in this direction span length is basically 24 feet, while in this direction the span length is basically how much? 20. So we have to calculate the moment of inertia of this half slab, okay, this half slab, either in this direction and either in this direction. So in longer direction as well as in shorter direction. Okay, so in, you can see that in this direction you have 24 feet, while in this direction you have 20 feet. Okay, so therefore you can see here computing alpha 1 for long horizontal span. When the span length is basically 20 feet, so So ice gross moment of inertia of slab 20 feet wide. So therefore, 1/12, 20, this is basically 20 feet, multiplied with a 12, converted in inches. So 20 feet is your width and depth is 7 inches. While so alpha 1 is basically the stiffness ratios. Okay, you can you divide the moment of inertia of EIE, basically the complete is same for both beam and slab. And they are different when you use moment of modulus of elasticity. You calculate modulus of elasticity of complete for slab and as well as for E. So as we need E because E is constant for both slab and column, sorry for beam. So just dividing the moment of inertia of beam to the moment of inertia slab, that's converted to be 0.63. One in other direction, when the width is basically 24 feet, okay, when the width is basically 24 feet, so we have to, that's in this direction basically, in this direction you have width 24 feet, while in this direction you have width 20 feet. So we will count for both widths, okay. So in this case, we have moment of inertia of slab, that's converted to be h2 32 inch to power 4, and moment of inertia is still remain constant for beam. So alpha 2 is basically what is the ratio 2.19, sorry, and alpha fm, that is the mean alpha factor. So taking average of alpha 1 plus alpha 2 divided by 2, we got 2.41. and now we will check the condition whether our alpha n is greater than 0.2, okay, as it is more than 2, so therefore we will do this equation. Okay, so therefore coming towards the formula, you can see that as it is more than 2, so therefore we will be using this equation. Alpha n is basically nothing, it is longer and shorter spans. Okay, so for longer 23 feet, because 24 feet and they are just subtracting the one column width, while in shorter direction they are also subtracting one column width, and 20 feet we will got 19 and 23. So beta is nothing, it is the ratio to the longer to the shorter, okay, spans. So by just dividing these two, we will got 1.21. So we will use alpha n is basically the longer span, okay. It must be remembered, alpha n is longer span, 23 feet, and 0.8 plus 60,000, this must be in that in psi 36 plus beta 1.21. One thing must be remembered, dividing these and you will get 0.5 0.6.4 inches. Okay, so this is just only a simple calculation. Okay, note that the interior panel will generally not control the required slab thicknesses. Usually it will be an edge or corner panel. The interior panel was chosen here to illustrate the calculation into a wide axis complexity. Had a corner panel been selected, each edge of the panel would have had a different alpha n. So this means that almost the thickness of the slab is controlled by the corner panel or by the edge panel, not by the interior panel. This the key purpose of this example. The other trying to illustrate you the calculation that how we can calculate those kind of calculations when interior beams are present. Almost, if you are calculating your slab thickness, you can select your corner or edge panel and you calculate. So that these panels are basically your controlling panel which control your thickness of the slab. So this is the calculation. Okay. The same calculation I can show in the Winter Mason book as well, and as in MacGregor as well. Okay, so in next lecture, inshallah, I will explain that how we can calculate a math and how we can solve the slab panel system by using the BDM model. Inshallah, we will start this example. Okay. The purpose of this present lecture is that you people know about how you can calculate the thicknesses of the slab system in the room. Okay, so if you have any question, Any comments, please share your comments and watch the video in there.